situation of Gaza and Palestine, and you know, its coverage of this recent act of aggression as well. So I'll just introduce Jeremy from Liverpool Friends of Palestine. Thank you.
Comrades, if we are staying here, can you make sure that people can get through and so on? Unfortunately, at a time like this, we realise why we don't have any members of Parliament here today. From Friends of Palestine, we...
If you shut up, you listen.
Before the general election, we warned people that if you vote for Labour Friends of Israel, that's what you get. And that is what we have in Parliament. I looked on Lushana Berger's website this afternoon because I thought there might be some recognition of what has taken place. And I find that the main entry is, what is your favourite South Asian restaurant in Wavertree? And I thought, well, maybe someone is really up to the minute and look at her Twitter page, which appears on also the front page of her website. It's up to date. And what did she do yesterday? She wrote, oh my God, what will my constituents think of what has been going on in Gaza? No, she didn't. Ate a barbecued trout for the first time. Strangely delicious. So that's what the Labour MP for Wavertree was thinking about yesterday when most of us were thinking about something else. This is an international atrocity. I think in the longer term, it probably spells the end of the blockade of Gaza, which Israel has continued on a comprehensive basis since 2006. They allow through very restricted types of goods. You can, for example, import cinnamon into Gaza, but you can't import coriander. It's that detailed, their list of what they can and won't allow in. And it's no surprise that it becomes necessary for the flotilla, as it's been called, to take supplies of goods of the type that won't get in. And they are boarded forcibly, unexpectedly, while in international waters, which you really are not supposed to do. And they're boarded from...
Assalamu alaikum.
My
name is Hikma. As you can see, I am not a born Muslim, I'm a convert Muslim. It's very important that you realize I'm British. I'm also part Lebanese. I'm not speaking on behalf of the Muslim community, I'm speaking on behalf of every being that calls themselves a human being. Yeah. At my last job, as witnesses will know who are in this audience, I was a nurse at the Liverpool Royal. In that job, I know that my friends have gone out with medical aid and they've gone with supplies, food and water, to whoever the food and water went to. They did not look to see whether it was Jew or Christian or Muslim or whatever. They gave that aid to whoever it was needed to. I'm here because I'm completely and utterly disgusted at the refusal of this aid to any brother or any sister, no matter who they are. I have with me, there are Christian friends in this audience. I don't know whether they want to come and join me, but if they do, they know who they are. I also have Jewish friends in this audience who know who they are. I have worked with these people on many, many times, and I want you to know that this is not just about Muslims. It's about the treatment of other human beings and the refusal of aid to those human beings. Okay. We have been raising money for
Gaza. We have been raising...
It's gone again. We have been raising money for Gaza, and I think it's important that we carry on doing that. But I cannot emphasize strongly enough, I don't care who you are. You can be black, white, pink, yellow dots, I don't care. If you're a human being, then you must say and do something about this. And you must get up off your knees and really get involved in making some activity that puts these people in their places. I am not a warmonger, I do not seek war, but I will not stand by and watch people starve. Thank you. Masalam.
very much, Hector. That was a very stirring and inspiring speech that you gave. I'd just like to hand over to Mark, one of the principal organisers of tonight's demonstration from Merseyside, Stop the War.
Thanks, Mark.
Hello, can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Salam alaikum. People are wondering why we are protesting here tonight outside the BBC. Well, I'll tell you why. The BBC, they like to tell everyone that they are impartial. They like to tell everyone that they are unbiased. Well, I have something to tell you. The BBC, when it comes to Israel and Palestine, well, the BBC is totally partisan. The BBC is very much on the side of Israel. It takes Israel's side. I watched the BBC's news today at 11 o'clock. The BBC gave 6 minutes to an Israeli Knesset member called Anna Wolf, who spent the whole time defending what Israeli soldiers had done, the slaughter of these peace activists. Then, the next thing, Jeremy Greenstock, Britain's ambassador to the United States during the Iraq invasion, he came on, and you know the first thing out of his mouth was, he said, was the need to stop Hamas's violence. Now, you know, as far as I know, this is not about Hamas's violence. It's about Israel's violence. It's about Israel's piracy and banditry on the high seas. The rest of the BBC footage was Israeli government footage of the soldiers boarding the ship, trying to prove that it was the human rights fault because they had fought back. Nowhere did it say that the hijacking of a civilian ship in international waters was illegal. Nowhere did it say that the blockade of Gaza itself is illegal. And why before these events had the BBC not been covering the peace flotilla anyway? I've been watching Al Jazeera in English for weeks, and they've been covering this flotilla all of that time. They had a full reporting team on board, 7 journalists. Now this flotilla is an historic flotilla. 600 people, including 50 European parliamentarians. There was lawyers on there, writers, academics, scientists, and get this, even Israeli Knesset members were on board, all trying to break Israel's draconian siege of the Gaza Strip. Now, this reminds me of the historic freedom rides in the United States, when human rights activists from the northern states travel down to the southern states of the United States to campaign against the apartheid conditions that black people in southern United States were treated to at that time. That was an historic moment. Now, the BBC couldn't even be bothered to covering this flotilla until these events happened. Why? Now, why didn't the BBC, for instance, show the disaster's emergency appeal last year to raise money for the starving people of Gaza? Every other TV network, including Sky, covered it, but not the BBC.
Shame on the BBC.
Shame on the BBC. Why aren't BBC commentators getting British government ministers on and asking them, why aren't they talking about seizing Israeli assets abroad?
Sanctions.
Why aren't we talking about Israel in terms of it being a rogue state, which is exactly what it is? Why aren't we talking about it as a state that needs to be kicked out of the international community? Yeah. Why aren't we talking about it as a state that should be made into a pariah state until it mends its ways? Why aren't we talking about seizing Israeli bank accounts? Why aren't we talking about sanctions? Why aren't we talking, why isn't this being put by the BBC to British government ministers? You see, if this was Iran had done what was done on the high seas yesterday, then this is exactly the way the BBC would be talking. But oh no, Israel will the BBC will never talk like that about Israel. The BBC will never use this language. It seems that with the BBC there are two sets of rules. One for one set of countries.